This week on The Art Show, we speak to Oscar-winning producer Iain Canning, and we play out with a classic track from Blondie. Welcome to The Art Show. Now, this week sees the start of the Soundtrack Film Festival in Cardiff. Joining me now is Oscar-winning film producer Iain Canning, who's about to hot-foot it over to the opening night screening of his latest film, Shame. Hi, Iain. Welcome back to Cardiff. Student in Cardiff in the 90s, is that right?
Yes. Yeah, just. Yeah. Sort of towards the end of it, but yeah.
So tell us, what were you studying back then?
I came here to study journalism, film and broadcasting, which was a very happy 3 years. And probably started my interest in film in many ways, because within that you could do modules on certain types of filmmaking. And so probably sadly learnt and watched all the most amazing films that could probably never get made now. That's the sad reality of having done a course then.
And Chapter Arts Centre played a big part in that, didn't it?
It did, yeah. No, I mean, that's where I saw independent film, whether that be US independent film or my company now is, there's a office in London and my producing partner is in Sydney, and we used to watch Australian films there. So yeah, certainly between Chapter Arts Centre and the Watershed Cinema in Bristol, that was where I got my film education.
So you're here for Soundtrack Film Festival. Shame, your latest movie, is opening, or it's the opening film at the Soundtrack Film Festival this evening. I think you'll be heading off over there very, very shortly. Can you tell us a little bit about it?
Yeah, sure. It's very interesting, actually, because it's screening, and I'm doing a few screenings, just come back from America doing a couple of screenings, and then it gets released in January. So it is a real sneak preview, really, in many ways, tonight. And it's the story of Brandon, a 30-something New Yorker who could be described as a sexual obsessive or a sex addict. And he lives in a very contained, modern, contemporary, quite well-off world where sort of having one night stands is his plan for the day.
Sure.
And into that very controlled world comes his very sort of wayward sister, who is a little bit of a sort of a love addict in many ways, and puts his life into a bit of a disarray because she sort of almost totally doesn't allow him to sort of live his life in his own apartment, and it's about what happens when he goes out into the world.
Sure. The soundtrack plays an important part in the film, so how crucial is it to the movie?
I think in many ways, I mean, I think it works in two ways. I think there's, well, three ways, actually. There's the score, which I think is incredibly important from Harry S. Scott, which is almost a character and very much tells us the sort of inner workings of Brandon. And then we have the texture of the city and the texture of the clubs and the nightlife. And then there's the sort of interior world of Brandon when he goes on his runs, which is the Glen Gould. And I think all of those combinations sort of end up making the film. And I think Steve McQueen as a filmmaker is very musically minded. So almost when he's watching a take, he's sort of feeling like the actors are live on stage doing a performance, and that's why he sort of chooses long takes.
Sure. And Steve McQueen, a Turner Prize winning artist. What was it like working with somebody from an artistic background on his second film?
I mean, great, because I think that people in their early part of their career just have such an openness to sort of changing things and doing things differently. And he'd lived in New York for a bit previously, and I'd never really spent much time there. So he was a tour guide, a director, and a sort of wonderful person to be around. And also, the film has strong subject matter, but what it always felt like was these incredible performances, very emotional in front of the camera, and then we felt like we were pretty much having a disco behind the camera. So
sure.
It was a good combination.
And of course, it was a very busy time for you during that period because of the King's Speech, and obviously that was your first film, first full production effort, I guess, which must have been incredible for you and your partner in Seesaw Films.
Yeah.
Tell us about the last year in your life. It must have been an incredible experience.
Yeah, it's crazy. It sort of feels like everyone stepped into my dream for a year, and it's sort of continuing as well with Shame. But I think that it was great being in America at the time that the award season, as it's known, was was kicking in, and being able to be around there when the sort of American audiences were going to see the King's Speech while also making a film there.
Sure.
And I think also making a film, because I think there would be a lot of, and previous winners of the Oscar have sort of said, you know, the biggest, scariest moment is when you think, what's next? And thankfully I already was shooting what was next, so
yeah.
And something completely different as well. So it was an incredibly busy time.
So did you actually know beforehand that you had won? Because I have to say, watching the acceptance speech, you seem incredibly focused. You're straight up there on stage. I will speak first. Was this sort of pre-agreed? Did you go through some sort of, you know?
No,
discussion?
I mean, I think we. I mean, thankfully, we'd had a little bit of practice by that point because we'd won a couple of other things. But but it sort of went in terms of the order of us as producer credits, and so I spoke first. But it was totally. I've never watched it back, and it's going to take a little bit of a drink, I think, to actually watch it back.
And the final question. The little gold fella, where's he kept then?
He is in my office, and much to the dismay of everyone I work with, who would quite happily... but if it was in the office, I think we'd end up with 700 million Facebook photos of, you know, ex-person next to Oscar, ex-person next to Oscar, and I think there's probably been enough in the first few months after winning it.
Brilliant. That was great. Thanks very much, Iain.
Thank you.
Now, one of the bands that features in the soundtrack to Shame is Blondie, and we play out this week with one of their classic tracks. This is Union City Blues.